Good morning, my dear students. So, good morning, PC. How are you? Fine? Good. Okay. So, today we will discuss about chapter number 5. Okay. Human Capital Formation in India. Chapter number 5, Human Capital Formation in India. Human capital formation. Human capital formation. Okay. The new chapter is human capital formation. So in this, we will discuss what one question number one. Okay. What is the difference between physical capital and human capital? Difference between physical capital and human capital. Physical capital and the human capital. What is the difference between both? So first point, point wise we will discuss first. Tangible. Okay, first point is tangible and intangible. Intangible. So which one is tangible and which one is not? Please let me know. Human capital. So when you talk about the physical capital like machine or equipments, building, machinery, so these are tangible. So physical capital is tangible, we can touch, we can see also with it. On the other hand, when we talk about human capital, so human capital is not tangible. Human capital, here we talk about the skills, knowledge. Okay. So it is intangible. And second, when we talk about this particular body, okay, human being, that myself. So I have not sold myself. What I am selling or I am offering my services only. So what I am giving, my services, does not mean that I have sold like a machine. Okay, so machines can be purchased and okay, buy and sell. Buying and selling take place in case of tangible, like you have purchased one machine. Okay, so purchased by you. But in this but in human cases, okay, human capital, this is not like that. We cannot purchase, only services can be purchased. Okay, so we are, what we are doing, human is selling his services. On the other hand, physical capital is tangible, okay, and human capital is intangible. Physical capital can be bought and sold, but human capital cannot be bought and sold. Point number two, honor. Honor. Okay, so physical capital is separable from its honor, separable from its honor, got it? And human capital is inseparable from the honor, separable from, separate, okay, separable from honor. And whereas human is inseparable and physical capital is separable, can be separated from the order. Mobility across space. Third point, mobility. So machine, once they are fixed, is they will not move. Okay, so the movement of the physical capital is sometimes not possible, or it may be fixed. Okay, physical capital is kept. Okay. Another way, when you talk about, when we purchase the export and import, in case of export and import, so export and import of physical capital is possible, like machine, that we want to purchase one machine. So mobility of the machine is possible from one country to another. Okay. So except few artificial trade restrictions, otherwise the movement is possible. On the other hand, human capital is not perfectly mobile. Human capital is not perfectly mobile means you have to, first of all, passport should be there, visa should be there that you want to work in another country. So passport, visa. So without visa or passport, you cannot enter in other countries. Okay. Human cannot means mobile like machines. Got it? So visa is not required in case of the machine. But in case of human, if you want to enter in another country, that you want to settle down or you want to start your business in America, so you cannot mobile yourself like a machine with it. Okay, so restrictions are there, and sometimes restrictions are there because of culture, because of language. Let you want to settle down in Russia. Okay, what you don't know Russian language, and sometimes culture is also different, so not easy. Let you, if you compare machine and human, so machine can be settled on any, okay, itself easily anywhere. Got it? That we are exporting one machine to Russia, so it will settle down easily. What if a person will move there, okay, settle down his or herself over there, so many problems he or she has to face. Language problem, cultural issues, so many things are there. This is about the mobility. Okay, next point number four, that is nature of depreciation. Nature of depreciation. As you know, there is a depreciation of physical capital. So value of the physical capital decreases over a period of time. So there is a depreciation. So continuous capital loss is there in case of this physical capital. And in case of human capital formation, okay. So when you talk about the human, so here when we talk about the depreciation, so that is in other way. Okay, like a person is getting aged, becoming old, okay, getting becoming senior citizens. So here we talk about the age wise, okay, age wise. On, and this cannot be replaced, okay, means can, and moreover, age of any person cannot be stopped, cannot be reduced. Cannot be stopped, cannot be reduced with it. Okay. So over a period of time, one day he has to leave this world. Okay. So if we want to increase the knowledge, so sometimes companies are giving the workshops are there. So education is there, trainings are there. Okay. So this way we are keep on updating this, this we can say capital. Okay. Nature of benefit. Fifth point, nature of benefit. So physical capital creates only private benefits. Private benefits means if it is your machine and if your machine is giving you profit, this is your profit only. That you are the owner of the company, and that whatever capital is there, physical capital is there, that capital will be giving you profit only, cannot give to others. Okay, so only private profit, or we can say benefit. Okay, when you talk about the human capital, so human capital benefit not only the owner but also the society in general. When you talk about this human capital, like trainings are given, coachings are given, and person is educated. So first of all, human capital will be giving the benefit to the organizations, but also not only to the private owner, but not only to the to its employers, but also giving the benefit to the society. Okay, so an educated person, okay, or well-trained person, mature person, he is also helping the society indirectly in his day-to-day life, contributing in the societies for the welfare of the societies. Okay, so this is about the human capital and physical capital, the difference between physical capital and human capital. So first point, tangible. So second, honor. Third, mobility. Fourth, nature of depreciation. Fifth is benefits. Okay, nature of the benefit. Okay, so this is your tangible. Intangible, when you talk about human capital, honor. So physical honor means you may be the owner of the physical capital, okay, because you have already sold this, that you have purchased it, so you will be the owner. When you talk about the human capital, so you here you have not sold yourself, but you have sold your services only. Okay, mobility. So perfect mobility is there in case of physical capital. Okay, when you talk about the human capital, mobility is there, but certain restrictions are there on the movement of human being from one country to another. Nature of the depreciation. So here wear and tear, okay, nor okay, wear and tear, accidental damages are there. So no doubt, due to the depreciation of okay consumption of the physical capital, the value of physical capital decreases. Human capital also decreases. Okay, that means due to with the passage of time, when it is becoming old and old, senior citizens, so value sometimes. But if you see, the knowledge always increases. Because of that knowledge, sometimes companies are giving conducting seminars, workshops to increase the knowledge. Though physically it is becoming old, but knowledge keep on increasing. Okay, so knowledge does not decrease, rather it keep on increasing. Then nature of, okay, nature of benefit. Nature of benefit. So direct benefit, whosoever is the owner of the physical capital, in case of human capital, direct benefit to the owner, as well as these are helping to the society also. Human is also helping the society. Now question number two, waiting. Okay, difference between human capital and human development. Question number two, human capital and human development. Human capital and human development. Human capital and human development. Okay, so what is the difference between human capital and human development? So human capital consider what, education and health. Here we talk about education and health, role of education and role of health for the human capital. So human capital consider the education and health as a mean of to increase the labor productivity. If a company want to increase the productivity or production, so has to give education and health, means which is why companies, they are recruit or employ educated person. Okay, as well as there is also a major role of health status. Okay, whosoever is not suffering, okay, or not feeling good, so there is a provision, means medical facilities are there, hospitals are there. Okay, and see, during this time, the role of health. Okay, so health is playing a important and crucial role. So companies, they are investing on the health, okay, protecting their workers also. Second, human development. So human development is based on the idea that education and health. So these two are integral part. When you talk about this human capital, means capital role of education and role of health. So these are the important integral to the human well-being. Okay, because people have the ability to read. If they have the ability to read, ability to read and write, reading and writing, speaking or listening. So these are basic things, basic skills should be there. So these are the part of human development. So if they keep on increasing, let we have very good education system. So human development will be there, and having well established health facilities. So person can live a long life. Okay, means he can live for the longer period of time. Let this time, see how many person there are those who are suffering from the COVID-19. But see on the other hand, recovery rate. So it is because of health facilities. Because of health facilities, okay, we can say around 90% people they are recovering. So recovery rate is very high. Got it? So recovery rate is very high. It is because of what we can say, health. So human development, health plays an important role for the human development. Okay. Second, when you talk about the second point in the human capital case, human capital. So it treats human beings as a means to an end. Means person should be used, his skills should be used in the economy, should be used for the production, okay, to enhance the production in the economy. So why these two things are given, education and health? So that he can increase the productivity, increase the productivity in the economy. Production can be, so because of higher education, training, skills, okay, good health, production always increases, productivity also increases in the economy. Okay, so output, if it is increasing, definitely GDP will also increase, GDP will also increase. So this human capital is also important, playing important role. On the other hand, human development. So human beings are ends in themselves. So when we talk about the right means there, when we talk about the human development, so if we are talking about 130 crore people, so each and every should have the right for the basic education and two time meal, okay, and proper shelter, basic needs should be fulfilled. If these all these basic things are, means we are getting, okay, so it means there is a human development. For human development, all the basic things are required. Education should be there, health should be there, then sanitation, two time meal should be there, shelter should be there. Okay, so all these come under the human development. Okay, literacy rate and lead means to lead a healthy life. To lead a healthy life, there is a role of crucial role of education and health that should be there for the human development. Okay, so this is about human capital and human development. Human capital and human development. Question number 2. Question number 3. Now question number 3. Sources of the human capital, or we have to discuss this topic. Sources of a human capital or factor contributing to human capital formations. Sources or factor which are responsible for the human capital formation. human capital formation. What are the factors which play important role for the human capital formation? Human capital formation. So, in the human capital formation, there is a role of education. So, investment in, first point, investment in education, which is why your parents are giving you good education. Okay, they had admitted you in a good schools. Okay, so all the parents, what they want that their child should be admitted in good school, they should go to the good school. Okay, should have higher and higher education. Point number two, after education, there is a role of health. So expenditure on health. Expenditure on health. So whenever a person, a child falling sick or not feeling well, so parents they want to give best doctor, best services, or approaching to the good doctor hospitals at any cost. Okay. So for the human capital formation, expenditure on the health always play important role. There should not be any compromise with the health status. Health. Okay. So health is also called wealth. Health is also called wealth building. So see right now, so all the countries, they are trying their best to make the vaccine. Okay, at any cost they want to make the vaccine and wanted to tackle the issue this COVID-19. So it does not mean that economy or country they are not doing like this. Means before this there was not such problem. So this is the new. So which is why this it is taking time. Means doctors they are taking the time, scientists they are taking the time. Okay. So but over a period of time, definitely there will be a definite dose or vaccine. Okay, which will be tackling these problems. Then expenditure regarding on-job training. Expenditure regarding regarding on-job training. On-job training. See, most of the companies almost everyone, all the companies, they are giving the training to their employees. When you talk about your school, so school is also investing on the teachers, providing the training, giving the training time to time. Okay, to enhance the knowledge. Okay, or to keep means over a period of time things are changing, technology is also changing, means also changing. So to combat with the change or to combat with the new situations, new things should be there, new things should be introduced, and person or the employees, they must have the knowledge about the new technique or new things. So on-job training also increases the knowledge. Fourth point is there, that expenditure on migration. Expenditure on migration. Expenditure on migration. So people migrate in search of jobs that fetch them. So why they are going to migrate? If a person living in the rural area or town or cities, so they are exploring the new opportunities in other areas. When you talk about metro cities or maybe in abroad. Okay, so they are keep on moving from A place to B in search of good job. So on expenditure on the migration, expenditure on the migrations. So this expenditure always open the new opportunities for them. Last point, expenditure incurred or anchor expansion forward, anchor for acquiring knowledge about what? Knowledge about the new job, opportunities. Expansion on the acquiring. Sometimes what we have like Naukri.com. So some of the people, they have subscribed Naukri.com, okay, and paid. They are their paid customers. Okay, let in a year they are giving maybe 5,000 rupees or maybe more than that. Okay, so that is up to the company and the customers what package he or she is interested. Okay, so to acquire the knowledge about the new opportunities. Now Naukri.com is a platform. This platform is giving you the information about the job opportunities in the different part of the country or maybe abroad. Okay, so expenses is also there to get this knowledge. So this is about sources of the human capital, sources of human capital or factor contributing to the human capital formations. So these are the factors contributing to the human capital formation. Investment of education, expenditure on health, expenditure regarding on job training, expenditure on migration, expenditure on and expenditure anchored for acquiring knowledge about the new job opportunities. Okay, new job opportunities in the different areas or in the international market. Okay, so this is about question number three. Any questions from your end? Okay, so one more question is there from high order thinking skill. Okay, question from high order thinking skill. Recently, Government of India has taken a few steps to reach 6% growth goal as a recommended by the Education Commission 1964. Or do you agree with the given statement? Give valid reason in support of your answer. So I am going to read the question again. Recently the Government of India has taken a few steps to reach 6% growth goal as recommended. Means step has been taken by the government. So means we have to discuss about those steps which are taken by the government for what? 6% growth rate. So it was this target was given by the or recommended by the Education Commission way back 1964. Okay, so if you are agree, then you have to support your answer. So this statement is correct to the considerations. Okay, so first point, in 2009, so Government of India enacted the Right to Education. So what Government of India did? Right to Education, it was passed in 2009. Right to education. So basic elementary education is free. Okay, so first class to eighth class, okay, first to six to we can say 14 years is, so those who are falling in this age group, education for them is free of cost up to one to eighth standard. So this is the step, okay, taken by the government to enhance the literacy rate. And now this is a fundamental right to get education, right to education. Second point, okay, apart from right to education, Government of India has also been started living to now what is there? There is a 2% education cess. Got it? Means whenever you're going to the market, so there you are paying the GST. Okay, earlier you were paying the taxes. Okay, so 2% education cess is there, which is collected by the government and invested only and only for education purpose. Okay, that money means 2% is not used for any other purpose. Okay, so that is dedicated, we can say a scheme, or means 2% dedicated amount for the welfare of masses. Third, government also sanctions a large outlay of promotion of higher education. So for the promotion of higher education, government is also giving the educational loan at low rate of interest. Okay, so why there is a provision for the education loan? Let you want to get the higher education. Okay, and in case of any economic problem, so you may take or you may borrow the educational loan from the banking system. So banks, they are giving educational loan. Okay, so that people can complete their education and get higher education, okay, best jobs by higher education. So these are the point in this case that is in, okay. So I'm repeating again. The question is, recently government of India has taken a few steps to reach 6% growth rate as recommended by Education Commission 1964. So right to education is there, okay, education cess is there, and educational loan. So three basic points are there which you have to elaborate. Next question is that is related to critical appraise. Okay, critically we have to explain the growth of education sector in India during 1952 to 2004. Means the education growth rate in India between 1952 to 2012. So critical appraisal. Okay, critical appraise of the growth rate of education in India. So first point, inadequate government expenditure on education. So during the period 1952 to 2012. So inadequate point number one, inadequate government expenditure. Government expenditure means government expenditure for the upliftment of education, it was less. Okay, time to time it was also recommended that around 10%, okay, 10% of the GDP should be invested for the education, upliftment of the education. When you talk about certain countries, those who are developed, they are investing huge amount of their GDP for health and education. Okay, so they are giving much preference for the education. So Education Commission in what happened? Education Commission in 1964 recommended that 6% of the GDP should be used for the education only, for the promotion of education. Okay. Second, so around means in the year 1952, around 0.52 means near half percent of the GDP we were spending on the education. Okay, education only. Second point, higher education a few taker. Okay, means the number of universities and colleges were less. Due to this, only few people they can get the higher education. Okay, or it was there, means it was achieved by only few people. Though opportunities were, means exposure were there, people they were talented. Okay, but due to this problem, means due to distance, we can say, means schools were far away, colleges were far away, universities were far away, or number of colleges or universities, we can also say, these were very less in the past. So due to this, okay, there was a means limitation is there always. Means number of seats were limited, so they could not get the means a proper opportunity, we can say, for their higher education. Third point, regional differences in the education attainment. Regional differences. So in 2014 and 15, the per capita public expenditure on the elementary education differ considerably across different states. So when we talk about Himachal Pradesh spending around 34,000-35,000, okay, as to low, and Bihar was spending only 4,000 rupee. Okay, so see the difference is how much money is spent by the state government to educate its people. So if they have given the example of two states, 34,000 by Himachal per person and 4,000 by Bihar to educate their people. Okay. Point number four, education for all. Till the distance dream. Education for all, no doubt is there. This Right to Education Act was passed in 2009. But still, education a far dream for a few people, we can say. Those who are living in the slums area or in the backward regions, still they are struggling. Okay. It may be because of unawareness, or sometimes they don't allow their child to go to school. Intentionally, they are not allowing their child to go to school because they are asking them to do labor with themselves. Okay. So where their parents are working at the same site or place, their children also working. So like this, few shortcomings are there. So this is about the critical appraise of the growth rate of education sector during 1952-2012. Okay. So this is about the main questions. Okay. So tomorrow we will discuss about the MCQ part. Okay, MCQ part. In case of any query or not, you can also text me, or right now you can also ask in case of any doubt. Okay.